Hare Krishna. It's wonderful to be here among all of you once again. And I'll speak today on the Ramayana on the topic of how character is reformed and how it is deformed. How sometimes things change for the good and sometimes things change for the bad. So I'll start with, we'll discuss three case studies from the Ramayana about how change happens. And we'll talk with three concepts.
So, weakness, wickedness, and goodness. So now, let's place this into like a table with three further columns. I'll add the characters over there.
Sure.
So here, when we are talking about these three things, goodness, weakness, and wickedness. So let's begin with the middle, weakness. So yeah, three over there. So as the, you can be seated here, and I'll tell you what to write over there.
Sure.
So basically, what is, thank you, all of us have weakness. Weakness means sometimes we get angry, sometimes we feel greedy, sometimes we feel envious, sometimes we feel lusty, whatever. So these are weaknesses which are there within every one of us. And simultaneously, there is some goodness with all of us. There are some good qualities, some virtues, some good habits. So goodness, weakness. Now, normally we talk about good and bad, or virtue and vice. But here I'm dividing this. Goodness is virtue, but vice you can divide into two: weakness and wickedness. What is the difference? In weakness, one does wrong, but after doing wrong, one feels bad. I shouldn't have done this. Basically, within us, there are two forces which can guard us from doing wrong. It's our conscience and our intelligence. Our intelligence guides us rationally. Hey, I shouldn't have done like this. And gives us reasons why I should not do this. And our conscience guides us emotionally. That means if we have a strong conscience and we do something bad, we feel bad about it. And that bad feeling, I don't want to feel like this. I'm feeling terrible. I'm feeling burdened by guilt because of what I did. I won't do this again. So both of these are like our inner guards, conscience and intelligence. So in people who have weakness, this conscience and intelligence are there, but they are temporarily overpowered. So suppose somebody is in a tempting situation. Say for example, nowadays in America, even in India, in colleges, there's a big fear of drugs. People get addicted to drugs. So now student life, like all phases of life, is stressful. And sometimes a student might just want, I need some relief. There's so much stress, this. I need some relief. And maybe some friend tells them, no, take this drug, you'll feel good. And in a moment of weakness, they take the drug. So that is bad. But still, after that, they will, what did I do? I didn't come here for this. And this can lead me down a very dangerous path. I'll not do this. So in weakness, we may do something wrong for some time, but we come back on the right track soon. But different from weakness is wickedness. Wickedness is where that person's conscience has almost become dumbed and numbed. The conscience doesn't speak. And the conscience doesn't feel also. So numb is you don't see no sensation. Dumb is no expression. So the conscience has become numbed and dumbed. And then there are some people who nonchalantly do terrible things. And I was once in Calcutta. We were going to Mayapur and just in the bus we were there. We were watching some boys. They were just chatting with their friends. And all of them were nonchalantly like they were picking up chickens and cutting the chickens. And cutting and the chatting. Now, like we might cut sabji, they're catching and cutting or lopping off their neck and then it's cutting into pieces. How is real life? And in public, in front of everyone, like, it's literally like we might talk with someone casually while cutting vegetables, they're cutting like that. So now, I wouldn't want to call those children as wicked. But the point I'm making is that sometimes the conscience can become completely dumb. So if that's what they've seen their parents doing, that's what is their profession, then they just get habituated to doing it. So to not feel bad on doing bad is terribly bad. Because then one inner safeguard that we have from doing bad, that has been removed. So conscience has been dumbed. And with respect to intelligence, some intelligence can get perverted. When the intelligence gets perverted, the intelligence, instead of controlling desire, it gets controlled by desire. That means that person uses their intelligence to do wrong in such a way that they will not get caught by it. They'll do wrong and then they'll carefully cover up their tracks. Once a person was pulled over by a cop because he was speeding. The cop asked him, did you see the speed limit? Yes, I saw the speed limit. I just didn't see you. So, the idea is, doing wrong is not the problem. Just be smart enough that you don't get caught while doing wrong. So, when the intelligence becomes a servant of the lower desires, servants of the vices that we have, then, so when both of these happen, when the conscience is silenced and the intelligence is perverted, the word is conscripted. Conscripted means that somebody, like say an Indian soldier, is captured by a Pakistani army, and then somehow that soldier is made into a Pakistani agent. That's like you change the party itself, so conscripted. Then for such people, what they have is not weakness. It is wickedness. Wickedness is where they do wrong and they sometimes not only not feel bad about doing wrong, they delight in doing wrong. They think it is my cleverness, see how much wrong I did and I got away with it. And this is the mentality Krishna talks about in the 16th chapter. Asaumaya hatha shatrur. Hanishye chaparanapi, Ishvaro aham aham bhogi, Siddho aham balavan sukhi. He says, this enemy I have eliminated. That enemy I will eliminate again. And in this way, I will become the controller. I will become the enjoyer. Who is there like me? I am great. Now we can almost envision that Krishna, when he was speaking these words, maybe he was thinking of Duryodhan. The demoniac was, this is what Duryodhan was doing. He was trying to eliminate the Pandavas. So there are demoniac people, and what they have is not weakness but wickedness. So wickedness is basically, wickedness is evil. Weakness is not evil. Weakness is just weakness. Wickedness is where, you know, one aspect of it is to do something wrong and then cover it up. Other aspect of wickedness also is that to cause pain for the sake of causing pain. All of us during the course of our life, sometimes we cause pain to others. Say if you are walking on in a crowded road and we are rushing for some urgent work, we might step on someone's foot and you might not even notice it. Now if you notice it, most of us will apologize. I'm sorry. Now, imagine if somebody is rushing along and they step on someone's foot and they notice it. That person says, and then they deliberately stamp on their foot. That would be evil. They are causing pain for the sake of causing pain. So that is also, wickedness is associated with evil. So Ravan in the Ramayana is said to be evil. He was wicked and he was evil. So he would cause pain and delight in causing pain. So basically, for all of us, the topic we're discussing is how is character reformed and deformed. So we'll take three stories from the Ramayana of how a character was affected. So let's start with the first. You could write here Kaikeyi and Mantara. And Kaikeyi, that is weakness. Mantara is wickedness. And above here, goodness, you can write Bharat. So basically, now weakness everyone has. Before I go into this case, one more point to establish over it. Weakness everyone has. Wickedness few people have. But what is especially dangerous is if weakness and wickedness come together, then wickedness will exploit the weakness. Just like I talked about this, say, student who might just occasionally take some drugs. And I feel very bad about it. But suppose there's a drug peddler over there. And that drug peddler spots, this student is a little weak. And deliberately dangles drugs, gives free drugs. And sends drugs to various people. Then what happens? When weakness is exploited by wickedness, then weakness also ends up acting in ways that are wicked. But that same student, you know, that student might be very honest and upright, may not only lie to parents, may steal money from their parents' place, and maybe rob from elsewhere. Addiction is often a very common predictor of criminality. Once a person becomes addicted, they go down. So a person who has weakness, if they become attached to somebody with wickedness, or if they become, or they come close, then they will degenerate. So now this is what happened in the Ramayana with Kaikeyi and Mantara. Kaikeyi had a normal weakness. Every relationship, when you go close, there are tensions. I met a devotee recently. He's a marriage counselor. And he said, I have seen only two kinds of families. He said, he was also talking about Western families. He's a Westerner, he's a counselor Western families. He says, there are two kinds of couples. Those who quarrel with each other and those whom you don't know very well. So you don't know very well, so you don't know that they're quarreling. So two people, when they come together, always there'll be differences. Mm-hmm. Now, if you see in the Shastras, in our scriptures, we have many cases of polygamy. Say one king has many queens. But you will see on every situation that leads to trouble. It almost every time you can see in the Bhagavatam, Chitraketu. It's like, I cannot imagine somebody poisoning a baby, and that to the co-queens, co-wives. So in the case, so something similar happens in Dashrath Maharaj's case also. Among his queens, Kaushalya is the senior most, but Kaikeyi is the youngest and she's the most attractive. So Dashrath becomes more attached to her. And because Dashrath pays more time and attention, see, in administrative hierarchies, in official administrative situations, there is like an official hierarchy. This person is at a higher post, this person is at a lower post. But in familial situations, there is no official hierarchy like that. There is more informal hierarchy. So what happened? Because Dashrath would pay more attention to Kaikeyi, spend more time with her. So Kaikeyi's stock in the royal family started rising. And Kaikeyi became more influential than Kaushalya also. Now Kaushalya naturally felt bad, but she was not resentful. Overall, things were fine. But still there was that tension. And Mantara exploited that natural tension between co-wives. Now Mantara had her own axe to grind. She had been a hunchback and she had often been the butt of jokes by many people. But in this case, because she was the favorite maid servant or the favorite queen of the king, she had risen in the royal staff and she didn't want to lose her position. And so she spun a whole story of how Ram's upcoming coronation is actually a scheme to deprive Bharat. And not only that is bad enough, but she made it even more personal. Actually, this whole thing is orchestrated by Kausalya so that she can become the king's mother, and then you will have to become her maid servant. And then she will get back to you for having usurped her position for so long. And none of this was true. But in this case, What happened was, she somehow believed it. And she believed it, and she ended up acting in horrendous ways. It's one thing was, of course, that Bharat become the king. That's okay, it's understandable. Every mother might desire that my son should become great. But to have Ram send him into the forest for 14 years, for no fault of his, that was outrageous. So what happened here? She had weakness. The weakness was that she was attached to the position that she had got. And that attachment was exploited by Mantara. And she ended up acting in a wicked way. And that was so serious that eventually not only was Ram exiled, not only was the whole Ayodhya drowned in agony, but eventually Dashrath also died. But still, that didn't change her. It was only when Bharat came back. Now, in her case, she was vulnerable to Mantara, but she was attached to Bharat also. And when Bharat chastised her, he says, what have you done? Did you say you are doing all this for me? You think this is going to make me happy? Sometimes some people create an imaginary conception of someone whom they want to please. Like sometimes, in some cases, some disciples do something thinking that they are doing this for the spiritual master. But they do a lot of things and then they tell this, and the spiritual master comes to you, I didn't want you to do this. And I think, no, all that I am doing is for Guru Maharaj. But did your spiritual master ask you to do something like this? If not, then don't imagine things like this. So anyway, when Bharat reproached her severely, he said that you are not my mother. You are the goddess of destruction incarnated in our family to destroy our whole dynasty. That was the time she was jolted out of her stupor. And then she came to her senses. But by that time, it was too late. Dashrath had already passed away and Ram had gone to the forest. Now, but she truly repented. And her repentance was that she went with Ram. She went with Bharat to call Ram back and implored him. Of course, Ram was firm and he didn't come. But still, the point was that although she was vulnerable to wickedness, she also had a connection with goodness. And that's why, although she became deformed temporarily, but she was also reformed. So within us, if there is weakness, if we all have weaknesses. So if our attachment to wickedness becomes stronger than attachment to goodness, then we'll be deformed. And if there's no goodness, then we may deform forever. But when the goodness comes back, here we are referring to goodness not as a quality, but as people with goodness. So this is association with wickedness, association with persons with people with wickedness, and people with goodness. Now, let's look at another case study. Here, we have Ravan, Vibhishan, and Indrajit. Okay. So where will Vibhishan fall? Goodness. Yeah. We can just write Vibhishan. The pen is becoming weak.
Okay. Vibhishan.
And Vibhishan. And then now where will Ravan fall over here? Wickedness. Okay. And where would Indrajit fall? Really? Why Indrajit in weakness? Okay, let me make it more specific, more generic then. See, Ravana's demoniac associates, all of them, where would they fall? Yeah, so here we have both Ravana in wickedness and Ravana's associates. You can write both over here.
Ravana and Indrajit.
This is Ravana, you can write. And you can just, below, you can... Rakshasas. Just write Rakshasas. Demons are Rakshasas, yes. So now, here also what happened, that... Now, Ravan was not just... It was not just an... a moment of weakness when he felt attracted to Sita. It was a whole conspiracy that he planned. And that was not weakness. That was wickedness. So now, in this case, when Ravan he started doing all this, there was actually there was not just Vibhishan, there were others also. So Vibhishan, of course, came into the picture very actively and said, give Sita back. Don't hold on to her. It will call the destruction of your whole dynasty. I have another whole, I'm writing a second book on the Ramayana. It's called Ravana Head. And there's one article that is Ravana had 10 heads, but zero brains. So 10 heads is what? Actually, I talk about 10 people gave advice to Ravana. And they all tried to advise from different perspectives. But even those 10 people could not put one brain in his head, you know, in his 10 heads, unfortunately. So anyway, the point was that Ravana did not listen to anyone. Now, we say, Lato ke bhoot, vato se nahi maante. Yes. There are some things which are non-translatable. If you try to translate this into English, the ghosts of kicks don't learn by words. It just doesn't make any sense. So he would not learn simply by some instruction, but when he saw demonstration of the power of Hanuman alone penetrated in Lanka and broke free from his guards and then burnt half of Lanka without any weapon at all, just the tail. So it's like Hanuman's tail, T-A-L-E. Hanuman's tail is centered on Hanuman's tail. T-A-I-L, tail. So it is Hanuman's tail with which he burnt. And after that, Vibhishan strongly spoke to him. He said, if one monkey can do so much, what do you think Ram with his whole army will do? Just return Sita. You have so many queens. Just give up your desire for her. So actually, initially, when Vibhishan spoke this, Ravana became a circumspect. And Ravana, he said, suspended the assembly. He said, we'll talk tomorrow morning. But the next morning, when Vibhishan went first privately talk to him, so what had happened all night, Ravana had been craving for Sita. And that unseated desire had blinded him again. And although Ravana had seemed a little cautious the previous night, the next morning, he was back to his insolent self. And then Vibhishan spoke to him. Ravana didn't listen. And then in the assembly, Vibhishan spoke again. And at that time, when Vibhishan spoke that, we will court destruction if we antagonize Ram, if we keep Sita. So at that time, various generals, they spoke. Prastha spoke, he said, why are they afraid of a mere monkey? It's not that he is strong, it's just that he caught us by surprise. If they come back again, it is they who will be in for a surprise. We are so powerful. Another Rakshasa said, actually, we should not even wait for them to come here. Let's all send an army behind and destroy them where they are itself. And Indrajit said, why do you need to send an army? I alone can destroy everyone. Just order me right now. And all of them started bragging. And in that, Vibhishan's voice was drowned out. So what happened is, generally if somebody is in wickedness, then it's very difficult to reform them. It's possible, but it's extremely difficult. And especially if somebody has wickedness and they're surrounded by people who are wicked, who have wickedness, then reformation is almost impossible. So here, there is not a happy ending, but the happy ending is that Kaikeyi was reformed and Kaikeyi and Ram and Sita, they all reunited after the exile was over. But here, there's only destruction. So, this is again a different subject, but just brief mention of this, that in general, we say we should always forgive. Forgiveness is a spiritual virtue. But then, our scriptures have wars, and war means people are killed. So, why is there no forgiveness in these situations? Forgiveness is to be given to weakness, not to wickedness. Giving forgiveness to wickedness is foolishness. It's like somebody is an armed terrorist and the person is just going killing around people indiscriminately. And then the police finally corners that person, or the anti-terrorist squad. And they will, oh, please forgive me, I'm sorry. And then this person lowers the gun, that person pounds down, pick another gun, shoot. And there are people who are wicked. And they have to be dealt with strongly. So forgiveness is important, but dutifulness is also important. Dutifulness means we all have to do our duty and we have to create facility by which people do their duties. And wicked people will not do any, let anybody do their duties. And sometimes punishment is required strongly. So this is the second case. Now, the third case is of Sugriva. So Sugriva will come in the category of weakness. And yeah, there. And you can put Tara in goodness. So which incident are we talking about here? Yeah, but which incident, can you guess? We have no
death of Bali.
Not death of Bali, something after that. Yes, Lakshman comes. Basically, good. What happens is that Ram and Sugriva form a deal that he will help Bali to Sugriva to get back his wife and kingdom, and then Sugriva will help Ram to find Sita. So, but at that time, after Sugriva becomes the king, suddenly the Chaturmasya starts. And normally we might think, you know, if somebody is lost or somebody has been abducted, just because of rains, you won't stop the search. But in this case, what had happened, Wali was the son of Indra. And because Wali had been killed, so Indra was angry. And Indra showered down unseasonally heavy rains. So nobody could move at that time. And that's why they decided to suspend the search for 4 months. And during those 4 months, Sugriva had been living in royal comfort. He was a warrior, but he had been living in comfort for a long time. And then when he had to flee, he had to live in Spartan austerity. It was extremely difficult. And then suddenly he came back and now he had all this royal luxury with him. So he lost himself in revelry. He lost himself in drinking and doing all kinds of things. And then the 4 months got over, the rain stopped, and still there was no sign of Sugriva coming. Then Ram sent Lakshman. And even before Lakshman went, Hanuman noticed what was happening. Hanuman noticed that Sugriva got lost over there. Now what happens in traditional societies, hierarchies are very important. So Hanuman couldn't directly instruct Sugriva, although Hanuman is much more powerful than Sugriva. Till now, he has not manifested his power. It's only when Jambavan speaks, then his power gets manifested. And even when his power is manifested, still Hanuman identifies himself. He says, I am a servant of Sugriva who is serving Ram, like that. So he couldn't directly instruct. But Hanuman talked with Tara. And then Tara came and spoke to Sugriva. He said, you know, you had promised this to Ram. And Hanuman also came and then said, yes, yes, yes. And then immediately he realized and he summoned. He sent summons to get monkeys from various parts of the world to come. But after issuing those summons, what happened? Again he relapsed. Again he lost himself in the same sensuality. And then Lakshman came over there. Lakshman heard all these sounds of revelry going on. And he became furious. He charged into the place where Sugriva was there. And he said, ingratitude is the worst of sins. You know, after having received a great favor from your friend, from one who has considered you a friend, now you are betraying him. You deserve to be punished. Seeing Lakshman's anger, Sugriva was stunned. He didn't know what to speak. So at that time, Tara intervened. And Tara said that Lakshman was angry, but Kshatriyas at that time, they were cultured. And generally, no matter how angry a Kshatriya might be, if a woman would come, they would calm themselves down. So he is angry, he tried to control himself. And Tara said, oh Lakshman, don't be angry with Sugriva. She said the temptations are so strong that even great sages sometimes fall prey to temptation. And Sugriva is just a monkey. and he has been deprived of pleasure for so long. Still, he has not forgotten his duty. He's already arranged for monkeys. And then Sugriv, he spoke. And then Lakshmi was pacified. So in this case, what happened was, there was weakness. Fortunately, there was no wickedness around. The dancing girls and whoever were there, they were not out to particularly exploit Sugriv. They're just doing their job. And there was weakness and a situation of temptation. So there was some fall. But because there was associate, because there was goodness, and he was open enough to listen to goodness. So there was reformation. So although there was temporary deviation, there was reformation. So in this way, these three cases we can analyze to understand how the character of a people can change, or can be deformed or can be reformed. Now for all of us, we have weaknesses and we can't just get rid of those weaknesses. What we can do is three things. First is that try to create a distance from wickedness. Now, wickedness is not just people with some horns coming out of their head. There are all kinds of people. Jayadvaita Maharaj writes an article in Back to Godhead, is called Who is a Demon? And then he says, demons are not just mythical creatures with horns around them. Right? No, your local politician might be a demon. Your grocer might be a demon. Your neighbor might be a demon. You might be a demon. So it's a mentality, it's not a form. So the point here is that we all have weakness within us. And there are also people around us who have wickedness. So when there is wickedness, then what happens? Now, it's not that, again, we'll put it this way, that it is some people have wickedness and some people are wicked. That's also a difference. That means some people have wickedness means with respect to one thing, they really are manipulative. They will speak this over there, speak that over there, and they will do this and do that. Some people love to gossip. It's like if you don't get bhakti rasa, then you get gossip rasa. Just speak something. See, what happens is, now what is gossip? Talking about others. You know when gossip begins? Gossip begins when you hear something you like about someone you don't like. What? When you hear you like about so you don't like. Oh, this person like this. I thought everybody, this person portrays as such a good person, but this is what I'll tell everyone now. So there are some people, they may not be wicked, but they have wickedness about something. You know, with respect to this, they will speak this over here, they speak this over there. And I'm traveling across the world, I've seen so many places. Like among, it can be in a family between husband and wife, it can be between two devotees in the same community. So many misunderstandings come up. Because usually, those two people can get along. There's some third person who comes in from somewhere and just gets those two people against each other. So if that is happening, then wickedness, if it is there, now we don't have to label people as wicked, but if somebody is acting in a way that is wicked for us, then we need to keep a distance from them. Keep a distance. Basically, there are some people who somehow bring out the worst within us. Sometimes they intend to, and sometimes they don't intend to, but they bring out the worst within us. Then keep a distance from them. Keep a distance from them. So that is first, avoid wickedness. Second is, strengthen your ties with goodness. That whatever good association we have, to strengthen those ties. What does strengthening the tie means? It basically means not just that, say, when two devotees come together, how tightly they hug each other. That's not strong association. That could be one part of it, but that's not the essence. The essence of strong association or strong good association is, strong bonds with devotees is that. Now, even if somebody speaks strongly to us, that won't break the relationship. Basically, what is happening? We are here, our mind is here, and people are here. So we look at everyone through the filter of our mind. If anybody speaks nicely to us, then we start, then I mean, immediately our mind says, what does this person want? Why are they speaking so nicely? So we see everything through the filter of the mind. But for people who are very close to us, what happens is, we see them separate from the mind. That means the mind is saying, this person has treated me so horribly. This person is saying, actually no, you know, that person was under big pressure. And that's why they did. There was nothing personal against you. Oh, okay. Now, I may believe my mind, but if I trust someone, then what happens? If I trust someone, close association means we trust that person as much as our mind, if not more than our mind. At least we hear an alternative. I saw a cartoon, two people are quarreling, and one person is trying to speak something. He says, whatever you say, I disagree with you. It's like, I just don't want to hear you at all. That's unfortunate. So strong association means we try to create bonds. Strong bonds so that even if we do something wrong, now we won't want to cover it up, we don't want to deny it, and we won't hesitate to speak it. So we need that strong bond with goodness. Sometimes we cannot avoid wickedness in the world. That's just the way the world is. We have to work with people, and some people are exploited. And you just have to, it might be a family member, it might be a relative, it might be a colleague. But we can't avoid that. But we can strengthen our bonds with goodness. And this can make a big difference. When we start getting on the wrong track, if there's someone who's watching us and someone, we tell them, then they will tell us how to protect ourselves. And third thing, this won't come in this analytical framework. See, there is weakness, wickedness, goodness, and beyond that is God. So it's connection with God, connection with the Lord. So with goodness, yes, we are pulled up, but ultimately we can't depend only on association for our protection. We also want purification. So by the connection with Krishna, so we could put God above this, and then we could, I don't think we have space, but so what happens is, if somebody connects with God, then from wherever they are, they can rise even from wickedness to goodness. They can rise from weakness to goodness. Now, can you think of somebody who, by chanting the names of God, rose from wickedness to goodness? Somebody who took joy in hurting others. Valmiki, yes, the Ramayana. No? That is wicked, half-killing animals. No, that was... That is Mugari, and he took joy in that, but then he gave it up. So the connection with God can actually raise us even from wickedness. And definitely it can raise us from weakness. But often that takes time. That transformation, inner transformation takes a lot of time. So we need outer protection also. And if we have this outer protection, then each one of us, from wherever we are, we all have our vulnerabilities, but we don't have to become overcome. We can stay protected and gradually get purified. So I'll summarize what I spoke today. So I spoke on this theme of how character is reformed or deformed. I introduced three main concepts: weakness. Is we mostly talk about good and bad, but within, so goodness is there, but in bad I introduce two categories: weakness and wickedness. Weakness is where we have our conscience and intelligence, which are two emotional and rational protectors, but sometimes they are overcome by the force of the situation. But afterwards we feel bad and we come back on track. But wickedness is where the consciousness is numbed and dumbed, and the intelligence is perverted so that the intelligence indulges and covers up. So now most of us have some weakness, and how weakness can be pulled down to wickedness or can rise to goodness. We discussed through three case studies. So in the case of Kaikeyi, she was manipulated by Manthara, and thus she acted wickedly, sending her stepson, who was like her son, who respected her like her own son, sending him away to the forest for no fault at all. She caused the death of her husband. But fortunately, because there was goodness and she was more attached to that goodness, that is Bharat, she came to her senses and she regretted, she repented. And the damage was there, but it was minimized. In the case of Ravan, he himself was wicked and he was surrounded by people who were wicked. So although Vibhishan's goodness was there, the bridge was like too far to go from goodness to wickedness, and he couldn't be saved. So he listened more to his own wicked desires and to the counsel of the wicked people around him rather than the goodness around him. So here he had to meet a bad end. So forgiveness, the scriptures don't talk about violence and war, because forgiveness can be given to weakness but not to wickedness. And then we talk about last case, which is could say more hope giving for all of us, that we all get deviated at times. Like Sugriva got deviated after getting luxury, after being in the forest for a long time in deprivation. But in his case, although there was a weakness within him and he succumbed, but there was no wickedness. Nobody was there to exploit him specifically. And there was goodness. There was Tara, there was Hanuman, there was Lakshman. And he soon came back on the right track. So there was very little damage, because within all of the 4 months, he was delayed. But the 4 months were anyway, then rain delay was there. So there was, although there was deviation, but there was very little damage over there. In this case, there was a lot of damage. In this case, there was irreversible damage, you could say. So what can we do to reform our character and ensure that it doesn't get deformed? Talk about three things. One was stay away from wickedness. We don't have to label people as wicked, but sometimes they have a wicked influence on us. They bring out our worst. So stay away from the wicked. The other was, second was, connect strongly with goodness. With some people in goodness, our bond should be stronger than when our bond with our mind, or at least equal to. So that we don't see them through our mind, we see our mind through them. We evaluate our mind through them. And the third is connection with God. So we can't depend only on association for protection. We need purification internally also. And the connection with God can raise people even from wickedness to goodness, and certainly from weakness to goodness. So all of us can stay protected and become purified. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So any questions or comments? Yes.
People, wickedness actually manifests in life through goodness. That is, you have some good qualities like helping others or something, and wrong kind of people come into your life and start exploiting you because of your goodness. And then you are further dragged away from goodness, because now you think that since I've helped that person, he has exploited, now you don't want to help anyone else. How to not fall into that trap?
Good question. So the question is that when we have goodness, then sometimes people with wickedness exploit us, and then we get burned by that. And then we don't want to even to help others. We give up our goodness so that we can have our protection. Yes. That is also illustrated in some ways in the Ramayana. Compassion has to be balanced with caution. And not balancing with caution is what is demonstrated through the example of Sita being kidnapped. It is not exactly compassion. It is a virtue. There was a sage, or a person who looked like a sage, and Sita wanted to serve. But Lakshman had told her, don't go out. Now, in this case, we can't really blame Sita, because it was a service attitude. But at the same time, there are wicked people, and we can't be naive in the world. See, basically, there are, I think everybody has understood this. Can you wipe this off?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry. Oh, okay.
Interesting. You can send it to me also then afterward. It's a good idea. So if we consider in our dealing with people,
could. Okay, I'll write it. We and others. So broadly, the way we relate with them can go like a pendulum. So one is, one extreme of this pendulum is naivety. And the other is cynicism.
That means naive people, somebody is naive, they think everybody is good. And if we are naive, we will be crashed and crushed. There are people who exploited you and people exploit us. So we will all experience this kind of betrayal or exploitation or whatever. So we can't live in the world while being naive. Say, we should be nice with people, but not naive. Nice means we are kind, courteous, polite. But it's not that we can indiscriminately trust everyone. So naivety is bad. And quite often from naivety, but we go towards cynicism. Cynicism means from everybody is good to everybody is bad. There's a prominent European philosopher who's an atheist. And he was asked, do you believe in hell? Now, obviously, the expectation was no, because he's an atheist. He said, yeah, I believe in hell. Oh, really? What is your conception of hell? He said, hell means other people. You can imagine what kind of misogyny is there. Misanthropy is there. Misogyny is hatred of women. Misanthropy is hatred of humanity itself. So, people can get burned that way and go to their cynicism. Now, in between these two, in between naivety and cynicism, is the courage to trust. Actually, trusting someone, it doesn't have to be an act of naivety. And being cynical is not necessarily a sign of cleverness. It's a courageous act to trust someone. But that courage has to be exercised cautiously. Courage cannot be foolhardy. A soldier cannot just rush into an enemy camp thinking, I'll defeat the whole army. But be courage, but caution. So basically, we will all, when we do something good for someone and it just backfires on us, we all will naturally go from naivety towards cynicism. But we can't stay at cynicism. We may think I'm protecting my heart, but it is actually, we are freezing our heart over there. It's not protecting. We'll become cold-hearted, we'll become lonely. And we don't want the virtues within us to go away. So the virtues have to be exercised properly. So Sita, she in some ways was naive over there. And the demon came and exploited it. So it's not that she is to be blamed. It is that she is a victim. But still, it's a part that it was a mistake on her part for her to do that. Of course, now here we are analyzing all these characters from an ethical perspective to learn something. From a transcendental perspective, it's all the Lord's Leela. And so you don't consider that while somebody, an exalted character, did something wrong. It's for our learning purposes. So when this has happened, we need to just become more cautious. So virtue is one part of virtue is also caution. So if somebody just gives charity, anybody asks for money, they give charity. Well, that's not always a virtue. If somebody is a drug addict and you give them charity, that's the worst. I mean, especially if you give them money and they take drugs, they're actually harming them. So we have to be, so giving charity is good. But if it is having a bad result, then it is not good. That doesn't mean we stop giving charity, but we have to learn to become cautious. News and clear. So this is, in between is the courage to trust. So that's how we have to work. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Yes.
I was just wondering, when a naive person has a bad experience and then they go to cynicism, what do you tell them to make them trust again to go back to the middle?
Okay, good question. When a naive person has a bad experience and they go towards cynicism, what can we tell them so that they can trust? Basically, when somebody is wounded, sometimes we can just be a part of the healing process. And it's, say, if somebody's hand gets fractured. So emotional wounds can be better understood with if we compare them with physical wounds. If somebody's hand is fractured, then there is a, during recovery, there is a phase when you just have to keep the hand at rest. Doctor will give a cast and just keep it at rest. So yes, if somebody has been hurt, they may have to go through a phase of withdrawal. Which I don't want it to do anything to with anyone. Give me my space. That's okay. But afterward, another part is that you have to start exercising. Although it might be painful, a part of the recovery is that you have to start exercising, moving the hand. So similarly, it's understandable that the person may withdraw into a shell for some time. But afterward, they have to come out. And usually at that time, we can try to help them remember that many times when people were good to them. The mind often obsesses so much on the bad that it blinds us to the good. Yes, people have been bad to us, but people have been good to us also. So we need to expand their perspective. We can't deny that people have been bad to them. But then, see, we may have to live with pain, but we don't have to live in pain. We will live in pain when we focus only on the pain and our consciousness gets reduced to that. But we will live with pain. We can't deny that has happened, but that wound is there. There's so many other good things in my life. So if you know them well enough, then try to gently help them think about the times when people were good to them. Not everybody is untrustworthy. So gradually, as that sort of memory comes in, then they will open up. So reminding them, first helping them heal and seeing what phase they are in. If they need space, give them space for some time. But then not forever. Then gradually to help them come out, remind them of the good in people, of the good that people have done for them. And then maybe based on your experience, your intelligence, whatever, we can just discuss with them and help them understand how they can be cautious while trusting in future. Like in no area in life do we have guarantee of safety or success. Even when we are driving a car and the car's brake may fail, or we might get a heart attack while driving the car, or there may be the next person coming around might be drunk. So risk is there everywhere in the world. You know, which is the safest place in the world?
Okay, great. Yeah, that's a good answer. It's a bit extreme.
But in many ways, a prison is the safest place. Especially if they're not like violent gangs and you're not a part of one gang and another gang attacking you. You could be safe in a prison. But do we want that kind of safety, which is a complete loss of freedom? No. So life has a trade-off. We have to make a trade-off of some of our safety so that we can have some facility, some freedom. So if somebody says, I want to keep my heart safe. So, well, that's like you are living in an emotional prison. And nobody has locked you. You have locked yourself in over there. Well, such people will become very lonely. And that is also a pain. We are meant to connect with people. Yeah, so ultimately, we are meant to connect with Krishna. But we don't connect with Krishna immediately. We are meant to connect with people. So it's a gradual process. But generally, we can help them in that healing journey. Thank you. Good question. Yes.
You know, one person is wicked. He has harmed a lot of people. Lord Ram had liberty to kill Ravan, but we do not have. We are bounded by law. So, what is our duty in that case? So, damage, you know. Society can be minimized.
If somebody is wicked and they have hurt many people, now Ram could kill, but we can't. We have to follow the law. It was not just Ram was God, Ram was also Kshatriya. Kshatriyas have to administer the law. So all of us have to consider our context primarily. That means Vishwamitra, when he was troubled by the demons, because he's a Brahmana, he could have cursed and killed them. But he asked Dashrath to send Ram. So generally, when something is wrong in our life or around us, then it depends on how strongly we are affected by it and how strongly we feel about it. If we want to make that a cause, that's what I feel strongly about it, then we may have to resort to the appropriate legal means to bring that person to justice. Now, that might be a long process, but in some cases, that's what is required. And that's what is required. That's what we feel. A lot depends here on individual. Some people may feel that it's a battle I don't want to get into. I just let me go on with my life, which is also okay. Because we can't change everything in the world. There are many bad things in the world. And as devotees, what we are trying to do is, we are changing the world by not just like correcting people, but by changing the forces that make people do wrong. Most of the crimes in the world happen because of lust, anger, and greed. Lust is the cause of most sexual violence. Greed is the cause of most corruption and financial irregularities, and anger is the cause of most violence. So, we are trying to cleanse ourselves of these things. And if we want to focus our energy on that, and we want to help others do that, then we just focus on those who are trying to change that and not bother about this. But it depends again on context. If you look at Srila Prabhupada's life, he had that temple in Jhansi, the League of Devotees. And the same people, some people turned against him, and there was a clique. And he just said, it's not worth fighting. Just left. He had legal expertise. He had experience in business. He could have made a court case and he could have protected that land. But he decided that this is a small city. The people here are also not that serious. It's not worth the fight. But later on, when the Juhu temple was severely threatened, if the temple was not there, but the land was there, that time Prabhupada fought. He fought fiercely. And he said, I will not, this Mr. N will have, if he has to steal Krishna's temple land, he will have to do it over my dead body. It was went to that point. And he fought and he won. Because he felt Mumbai is a very important place. And now he had a vibrant movement in the West and he wanted a good place in the financial headquarters of India, and therefore he felt it was worth fighting. So we may have to decide whether it's worth fighting for us, and then based on that we do. Okay, thank you. Yes, if they come, that will be wonderful. Yes, you know, if they come and somehow even wickedness can be transformed.
Make others wicked in the
Bible. that would be a test for all the devotees.
That's true. See, we all, it's one thing to be tested, but it's quite another thing to be manipulated. Sometimes people are wicked people, they're so cunning that you don't even realize you are being outwitted, that you are being manipulated. Some people are just so expert at that. It's like they wrong others and then they portray that they are the wronged person. It's amazing how they do that. Some people are just expert at that. So, you know, it can lead to a lot of problems. Of course, we don't want to reject everyone from anyone from the path of bhakti. But again, we can't be naive. If everybody is welcome, but what is the effect of certain people on us, we have to see. But it's good to see such optimism in the potency of devotion. Thank you. Yes. Any other questions? Yes.
Guruji, it is it's very easy to see or to assume that I'm not wicked and I'm good. and to feel that I am being troubled by the wicked people. It's easy to see that I'm good, I'm not wicked, and I'm troubled by wicked people. But the fact may be that I have some wickedness which I myself do not accept it or do not know of it, because I'm so used to being wicked. And the people whom I see as wicked, they're not really wicked. It's just my assumption, my imagination, or my misunderstanding. So it's very common to see that even the wicked person thinks that I am good, and I am being troubled by the wicked. And so how do we see our own wickedness when we are convinced that we are good?
Sometimes we may have wickedness, but we think others are wicked. So how do we see our wickedness? It's difficult. You could say the example of Duryodhan. Duryodhan, during the then Krishna had come with the peace proposition. Duryodhan said that, even after great introspection, I don't see anything wrong that I have done. And he said, I have simply acted according to my nature. So if anyone is to be blamed, blame the creator who gave me my nature. That's a great excuse. See, our past can explain our emotions, but our past doesn't excuse our actions. Sometimes some people may just be very suspicious, very short-tempered, and they may have had that kind of upbringing, that kind of experiences. So how we feel, that can be explained by our past. We can't really that much control our feelings, but we all have the capacity to control our actions. So that's why our past can't excuse our actions. So in this particular case, it's like Duryodhan, who doesn't even think that I am doing anything wrong. In that situation, I think 2-3 things are required. Sometimes we just have to go through the school of hard knocks. That means, you know, we really are knocked around and we bear the consequences, and then we realize, hey, it's I who am wrong. And another part of it is also that, okay, even if it is true that I am being exploited by wicked people, this is difficult to apply, but whenever there's conflicts, if this can be applied, it's a very powerful way to resolve conflicts. Let's say two people have an argument, heated argument or whatever. Then first thing is both of them separate. They calm themselves down and then think seriously, what did I do to cause this conflict? Now, it might be that what I did is 1% and the other person had done 99%. But admit that I shouldn't have done this. Start with that one. What did I do? See, basically, when something bad is happening with us, there are two possibilities. Either I am bad or the rest of the world is bad. Now, saying that the rest of the world is bad may be good for my ego, but actually, it's disempowering. Because are you going to change the rest of the world? Well, good luck with that. It's good in a sense if there's something wrong with me. It's not that I am just saying that, oh, it's all because of me. But if there's something wrong with me, then there's some chance that I can fix it. If I'm just saying that nothing wrong with me, the world, everything is wrong with the world, well, then that's not a very pleasant thing. Usually it's not true.
But believing that is very disempowering. It's like, suppose you go to a doctor, you're sick. And the doctor says, the kind of symptoms you have never heard of it. Well, that's not a very pleasant thing to hear. My ego may think, I've got a unique disease. But that means the doctor has not heard, the doctor can't cure, isn't it? So, for us, we only have control over ourselves. And that also we have limited control, but at least we have some control over ourselves. With other people, we have very, very little control. So it's good to try to begin with ourselves. Okay, maybe this person is exploiting me, this person is abusing me. But am I doing something? Am I also doing something wrong? This is not to say that others are not doing something wrong, because that is very difficult for us to accept. But am I doing something wrong? That is, if we start with that, okay, then I'm doing this, let me set this right. So it will be very difficult for us to accept that there is wickedness within us. But we can say at least weakness is there, and let me try to reform that. And if the capacity for introspection also grows by exercise. If today I can admit, like, maybe 1% fault within myself, then tomorrow, the ego makes us feel that if I admit a fault, I'm going to die. It's like one friend, recently I had one devotee friend of mine, he's a proper disciple, he treats me very friendly. He said that, you know, some people think that apology will kill them. They just can't apologize. They'll hem and haw and everything. They said this. One simple apology is what the other person wants, but they just can't give it. But if we admit one fault, 1% fault if we admit, then we realize, actually this apology didn't kill me. So, no, it might seem like joking, but it's not. For some people, death is preferable to an apology. We just can't do it. But if you understand that apologies don't kill, then gradually, I can admit 1% fault. Maybe next time I can admit 2% fault. So gradually that happens. So we have to begin very gently. And inner transformation is generally not very dramatic. It's not very rapid. Sometimes it may be, but generally it's gradual. So those are some tips. That makes sense? Okay. Any other last question? Same question or similar question?
No, I think I had a question that most of the times we have all three, right? Goodness and weakness. And sometimes it's just recognizing which one is more powerful. Perception, not influenced by one or the
other, and you take that, you stick more with the goodness of the weakness. Weakness cannot influence the wickedness. And it's kind of how to deal with that. So, if I understand right, is the question that how do we deal with our own oscillation between goodness, weakness, and wickedness? Yeah. There are, let's use general word vice. The vice can manifest sometimes as weakness and sometimes as wickedness. So we all, the vice within us often has urges, or rather, because if you use the word urges, our urges have surges. So we might have a certain level of anger, but sometimes it just zooms up. Shoots out. So similarly with lust or greed or attachment or anything like that. Now, when they shoot up, we might just be powerless. So even if we can't resist the urges, we can persist between the urges. okay, that time that thing happened, I couldn't do anything. Okay. But, and it may happen again. But in between, what am I doing? In between, I just give up. I can never change it. And in between, I just keep beating myself up. Why did I do that? Or in between, I try to connect myself with goodness. So sometimes wickedness may overpower us. And if we can, if in between we are connecting with goodness, we are strengthening ourselves. And gradually, what will happen is when wickedness comes up, we'll be strong enough to resist it. So at least persist between the urges. I write on the Gita every day at GitaDaily.com. So one article I wrote was that we may fall down, but we don't have to fall away. Fall down is when the urges have surges, we just do something wrong. But fall away means just give up the practice of bhakti. Thinking, I can't do this. So we may fall down, but we don't have to fall away. That's the first thing, persist between the urges. Second thing is, keep a distance from provocations. So sometimes something external causes the surge. And if we know something causes, just keep a distance from it as much as possible. And third is a little tricky to understand, but if you understand it, it's a very transformative insight. It's that, see, when the urge comes, it starts growing, 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 and we feel it's just going to grow forever. And if I resist it, it's a losing battle. I may resist now, but it's going to grow further. It's going to grow further. It's going to grow further. How long can I resist it? And then we give up. But this urge is not going to grow forever. It will grow, 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 grow. It will attain a peak. And then it will go down. So it is something like arm wrestling. It's like our battle with our urges is like an arm wrestling match. We are trying to hold, and the urge is trying to push us down. But the critical thing is, here it's like a timed arm wrestling match. That means, say it's a 3-minute round. And in 3 minutes, you have to get that hand down. Now that the opponent may be so strong, they just got our hand down, down, down. It's almost touching. It's so much pain. But the minutes are ticking. And 3 minutes, we just hold on, hold on. Then, if we just survive that present round, the next time when we begin, it will not be from here. It will be from neutral ground. So, if you understand this urge is not going to go on infinitely, then it becomes easier to resist that. It requires strength, it requires determination. But it is, if we think this is battle forever, the urge may come again also. The surge may also come again. But next time, I won't be here. I'll be here. The urge has to get me down from here to here. So if you understand, it's like a timed arm wrestling match. So it's not that we always have to battle with temptation at one level. But that intense temptation or intense vice that we have to battle with, that's not 24 hours a day. So if you understand that, that also gives us some impetus to resist. And ultimately, of course, we have to find out something that connects us with Krishna strongly. That means that there are some things which we like to do and some things that are good for us. If these two were identical, life would be wonderful. Of course, but it's not necessary that the two are entirely disjointed. If you can find out somewhere these two intersect and hold on to that, make that as easily accessible as possible. So if you like music, then have some kirtans ready with you. If you like deity worship, then have some attractive darshan, picture of Krishna with you. And then look at it. Pray to that picture. Pray to Krishna through that picture. So whatever it is that is good for us and what is also what we like. Because at that time, if something is good but we don't like it, it will be very difficult for us to redirect our thoughts there. But in that, we can redirect our thoughts. So then gradually, by that we can resist. So we can persist between the urges, then protect yourself from provocations, then know that the battle doesn't go on forever. That the urge also doesn't last forever. It's like a time arm wrestling match. And to gain strength during that, find out something which is good for you, and which is like some, like something is a circle of bhakti and it's the circle of what you like to do. Just find something within that. Then it's possible to resist it. Okay. So now the last question. Okay. Yeah. You raised your hand and you did. Yeah, please.
If someone
we know very well is overcome by wickedness, how can we help them to come to goodness? First thing is that if we are drowning, we can't save anyone else. So if somebody has succumbed to wickedness, and if we go there to help them, instead of we lifting them out, they may pull us down. So we have to be cautious. You know, compassion or concern for others shouldn't blind us to realities. See, it is that I was giving a seminar to mental health care providers who take care especially of people who are addicted. And I was talking about this principle, but then one of them spoke it very articulately. He said that actually in such fields where somebody is addicted and they're trying to recover and they have relapses, he said that if the caregivers are not to get exhausted, there is what is called as compassion fatigue. Just, you see so much suffering and then you just don't have so much capacity left to empathize. So there, the point is this, they say don't work harder than your client. Don't work harder than your client means what? This addiction care your provider. That they want to, when this happens, do this. When this happens, do this. Come and talk with them. But if the addict doesn't want to change, then you don't get worked up by that. It's sad to see somebody going down, but you can't afford to go down with it. So this is the first principle. If somebody has become wicked, then we have to make sure that we don't go down with them. Second is that there has to be some desire to change within them. If there is no desire to change at all, then not that we abandon them, but we may have to suspend our efforts for the time being. Keep the door open. They want to change, we are there to help them. But we can't force anyone to change. The standard example for this is, sometimes say a car is not starting and then a group of people come around and they start pushing the car. The person from inside is trying to steer and move the car, people from outside pushing and slowly the car starts. But suppose people from outside are pushing and the person inside has gone to sleep. Then the people out, why should we push? Or worse still, the person inside is pressing the brake. And the people set up. It's a vain effort. So we can help the unable, not the unwilling. We can help the unable, not the unwilling. So there has to be some desire within them for help. We can always be there as a friend, but we don't want to be dragged down. And having said that, so these are two cautionary notes. That we shouldn't be dragged down. Secondly, we should that they should have some desire to help. But broadly, how do we help them? See, any transformation, there's only three ways in which one person can help another person. Basically, you could put it as enlightenment, engagement, and encouragement. Enlightenment means that show them, help them see the future if they continue on their path or the future if they can change their path. So help them. See, sometimes we tell them this is bad, don't do this. That doesn't help. That sounds like moralizing. Here, enlightenment means help them to see the consequences of their actions. It's very important that we don't just give rules. This is bad, don't do it. No, explain why it is bad. So enlightenment means not that I am instructing you, but this is what I have learned. So show the consequences. That's one thing. Then second is engagement. Engagement means help them to have a path to change. Okay, that means say somebody is falling for wickedness because they have that kind of friend circle. Then maybe we try to invite them to our friend circle. Maybe if they are in some extracurricular activity, then some playing some sports, and that's where that friend circle is. Then maybe get them into some other sports. So we have to provide them some engagement as much as we can. And third is encouragement. Whenever anyone tries to change themselves, there are going to be falls. There are going to be relapses. Then we need to encourage them. Yes, you can change. I was in UK and one devotee came and told me, after many years, now I have developed renunciation. Oh, really? I said, what do you mean? I had developed renunciation toward renunciation. So, sometimes people just give up. But we need encouragement. Yes, even if you slip and fall, you can rise again. So, encouragement. So, we have to see these three things. Basically, that knowledge, facility and hope. Put it another way. Knowledge of the consequences of actions, facility to do the right thing, and the hope that you can change. So enlightenment, engagement, encouragement. If you give these three things, it's definitely possible that we can become an instrument for them to come back to goodness from wickedness. Does that answer the question?
Yeah.
Thank you for this very thoughtful question. So thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki. Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki. Jai Gaur Premande.
Shri Chaitanya Charan Prabhu ki.
Jai.